Away the thrush from VandeR. He's been his main champion.
VandeR life, indeed. So, picks and bans are coming thick and fast. You can see Ziggs and Kale being taken away by Alliance. Katadin and Lulu taken away from Alliance. That's a big one. There is the thresh ban, as you mentioned, taking it away from VandeR.
And also, actually, Sin, the very last ban from RoCCAT here.
Wow.
Alliance, though, instant locking Jax. So, they clearly were sitting ready here saying, okay, with the last ban, if it's going to be Jax, we first pick Lee Sin. If it's going to be Lee Sin ban, we just first pick the Jax and be happy.
And you can see there, it's actually, it's not an insta-win Jax anymore. You have to work at this one. It's not like we've got Jax, therefore, game over. GG, thanks for playing easy and all that that you can put into Dexter and get banned for, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. But RoCCAT, how do they counter this one? You can see immediately they've slowed things down. They were fast, 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 ban, ban, ban. And now instantly, Zazzus is like a, I don't know, like rabbit in the headlights, maybe at the side. It's like, I'm up against Jax in the top lane. What am I going to play?
So the weird thing here, or the surprising thing, is actually Alliance first picking the Jax, because they normally leave it open for the other team. Other team locks it in, and then they go Shyvana against it. Due to lane swaps early on, deny the Jax a lot of farm, and Wickd can then beat him one-on-one. This time around, they're like, nope, we just first pick Jax, take it away from Zazzus, so now he's forced to take something else.
Well, with Lucian locked in, it seems, for Celaver, that leaves Twitch open, don't forget, for Tabzz. I'm pretty sure that's what Alliance are going to go with. Thresh is taken away, so will we see potentially a Morgana alongside it? Looks like it's going to be a jungle decision, of course. Lee Sin was taken away. Shook and Jankos have played down in the past. Elise, though, is one of the favorites of Jankos, so this could be taking it away from their opponent.
Yeah, we just saw him swap over to Elise and then instantly back to Shyvana, so they were thinking about picking the Elise early here to make sure they could secure it. Of course, Evelynn and Kha'Zix both are still open, so a lot of options for Jankos. I would expect the Kha'Zix, but Evelynn is just as likely. When it comes to bottom lane here, if Alliance actually locks in Morgana, I really like it, because VandeR has been playing quite a lot of Leona, and now with Morgana, of course, you have at least a counter pick or the Black Shield counter towards Leona. There's still room for outplay, of course, for Leona, but still, Black Shield does a lot.
He's also been playing that champion that's currently hovered over a lot in solo queue. If you look, check out his history in solo queue. It's 8 out of the last 10 games, I believe it is. We just checked it a few moments ago for that one. Nami all the way. So VandeR's going to be just as comfortable on that champion. And it is another champion that requires skill shots, much like Thresh.
And actually what I like about the pick here with Evelynn is the engage you can do, the combo between the two, where you first land the ulti from Evelynn, which is now maybe being delayed.
He's just laughing.
Okay, so if it is
We're going to give Yorick jungle, and he's like, no, please.
The engage you can do for RoCCAT, where you land the ulti from Evelynn, follow up by Tidal Wave, follow up by Shyvana jumping into the enemy team, is a lot of things to pile onto the enemy AD carry. So if it is Twitch or Kog'Maw from Alliance here, it could actually be risky, because you're not very mobile. So all these ultis here from RoCCAT can actually get onto you.
Well, of course, there's a heavy Korean influence on Alliance lately, so we'll see whether that Kog'Maw does get selected. Has started to see a lot of play over in the OGN champions, and of course the qualifiers that are currently going on. So we'll see whether Kog'Maw gets in there. Lucian, no surprise that Celaver went with Lucian. It was kind of a champion that we were doing our pre-draft, I think you could call it, of our picks and bans, and we were pretty certain that Lucian was either going to get banned away or selected by RoCCAT.
Oh, Froggen.
He's not going to play it. He's just baiting.
He did actually tweet, Anivia is back, so maybe.
Oh, it is. It is, ladies and gentlemen.
Wow.
Anivia for Froggen.
Very, very nice here. So I think we can call it a comfort pick for Froggen here. He's probably the best Anivia
player. Pretty safe to call it that.
In the world.
1,000+ games in
so many years. I'm really, really looking forward to this here. And let's see what Overpow wants to play against it, because you don't see Anivia very often. So it's not a champion you practice a lot against.
And you know, we were looking at actually a number of players' accounts. And of course, he's always said, I've got 1,000+ games on Anivia. He's only played like 4,000+ games. So a quarter of his games, his entire games, are on Anivia. He knows all about that champion. Will Overpower look at his face? It's just like, well, I've not done this one in a while. Will it be Mordekaiser?
I don't think so. That would be a very, very scary lane for.
Yeah, that's not going to go well for Mordekaiser. Gotta just.
I mean, he could. No, Ziggs is even banned away. TF as well. I mean, there's a lot of kill pressure here onto the Twisted Fate from Froggen on Anivia. So we need to see at least Jankos paying a lot of attention to this mid lane here in case Overpower needs the help.
So actually, now let's look at the teams. Let's see what control it offers, because when we know what control Anivia will offer in that team, and it actually works very well. Obviously, the wall, Glacial Shroud, everything, the slowdown, massive slowdown for everyone, which when you look at it, the Evelynn has got to get in, the Shyvana's got to get in there. This is now problematic for RoCCAT, and I think it's maybe a twist that they probably weren't expecting in picks and bans.
100% didn't expect it. You just saw Overpow here when it came down to the last pick. And Alliance, they have so much disengage and peel potential. And then you have the Jax just split pushing by himself, joining in with Teleport for the team fights. So as long as Alliance here can get Wickd going, avoid it, a bad early game for him where he gets denied a lot of farm, then the team fight, just by having Tabzz on Kog'maw, just by having the Morgana, Anivia and Elise, I mean, there's so much kiting potential, it's so much CC as well. I mean, land a Cocoon, land a Stun from Froggen, land a Binding from Nyph, there's a lot of CC onto targets here that can just get bursted down instantly by Alliance.
And well, despite obviously the split from CLG EU, that's a very CLG EU-like tactic that they've managed to pull out the picks and bans. Pete would be happy on Kog'maw. So now that the lineups are locked in, do you still think Alliance will win this one? Tell us by tweeting hashtag AllWin or hashtag RockWin, and remember to use at LOL Esports, because we won't see it otherwise. It's kind of pointless tweeting that otherwise, wouldn't it? We're going to check out the results as the game gets underway. What do you think? What are you seeing from picks and bans? Do you think RoCCAT will be caught out that one?
Well, obviously they're surprised about the picks from Alliance, even from the first pick Jax here, where they've gone Shyvana in the past weeks from Alliance side. But RoCCAT's comp is not bad either. I mean, you have Lucian and Nami. It's a very strong tower pushing comp. You have, of course, the Twisted Fate to port around Shyvana. We know how strong she is. So it's not like the comp here from RoCCAT is bad, just not the same with Anivia.
So here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Game one about to get underway. European LCS. This is week three, or game day three, whatever you'd like to prefer to call it. First games of the day. Of course, Alliance is the blue team and RoCCAT as the red team, playing from top to bottom.
And we need to see how Froggen wants to position in teamfights when it comes to his wall. Because if you look at the lineup from RoCCAT here, Shyvana, of course, can jump across the wall here. Twisted Fate can port in, land onto Tabzz if he builds an Hourglass, stun Tabzz, and then use the Hourglass here while the rest of RoCCAT pile on to Alliance. And of course, the Evelynn wants to flank around anyway. You don't want to engage from the front with Evelynn. So it's going to be hard for Froggen to find the right places for the wall here. But if he hits a perfect one, he can actually zone out both Lucian, Nami, and of course, even the Evelynn.
Well, you say that, of course, we have seen Froggen on Anivia fairly recently back in Paris, up against Bjergsen's Zed, which actually was a lane he had no chance of winning, really, even in his own mind. He was like, I'm not sure how this is going to work out, because Zed should dumpster Anivia. But it didn't work out that way. And we all saw Froggen have an immaculate game and perform brilliantly. So still hasn't lost that mechanical skill on Anivia that he's pretty much always had. Alliance are looking to set something up here. Potential late invade towards the red. Of course, there is a ward that would spot that for RoCCAT. You can see, of course, you guys are home now seeing that Anivia in there have upped your vote to 89%. So it was 85% earlier on. And it will be a five-man invade by Alliance.
So they want to go in here and try and spot out RoCCAT and make sure they choose the lanes. And they're actually sending both Binding and a Q from Froggen. So if there'd been a target in this one, he'd been dead.
He would have been dead. It would have been chain CC'd, but red buff invade is on. You can see it's Wickd and Shook that are going in there. So this is showing signs that it could be a 4-0 split push in that top lane straight away, which is why we're seeing VandeR in here starting out that red buff. Jankos will come across. VandeR's going to pull that one right around. You can sort of see in the top area the buddy system in action, which is Shook and Wickd working down the golems.
And Alliance don't actually need to fast push anything here. They rather take their time and get some levels, because you want to get a few levels on to Tabzz here before he can really start dueling against the Lucian. You want to get a few levels on Wickd, of course, before he can deal with the Shyvana. So for Alliance here, they can just make a very slow lane swap and just farm away in the jungle with Shook and Wickd together, and just wait for Tabzz as well to get a few levels, and then Froggen in this mid lane here with both Shook and Wickd around him as well should be very safe.
And we just saw Zazzus actually backing up there. He went back towards the golems to see whether he could get some extra experience, maybe try and get himself to that level two, but it wasn't to be, because of course we already saw that Wickd and Shook had been there. Shook's just backed off. They're on the blue buff. You can see there is a pause right now. It is RoCCAT that have called for it, which is why I've seen the referees heading over to him. Looks like it is Overpow, so he's just restarting his client. So we'll be back underway in a moment. He's saying, you know what? I'm a little confused. They've got this blue bird in the middle. I've not seen it for a while.
I'm not sure the referee can help him on how to lane against Froggen on Anivia.
Well, especially Taco.
He knows everything, of course.
Who knows? But they're just obviously sorting the client out, so they'll be back underway in a moment. Good start from both teams. They have both countered each other, gone for the red buff. So red buff has been taken for both of them. And actually, we're seeing a bit of a split, though, because Zazas is kind of on an island right now in that top lane. So he's been singled out where, of course, the buddy system, as Jack likes to call it, with Wickd on Jax, has been following Shook, basically mirroring him every step of the way around the jungle.
I definitely think it's in favor of Alliance that we have the lane swap, and that's why Day3D1 wants to invade in, decide the lanes here. Because the Nami and Lucian lane against the Kog'maw here, there's a lot of pressure that can apply onto Tabzz here, a lot of kill pressure as well, because Kog'maw doesn't have a jump. So you just put your Nami E onto Lucian, hit the first slow, and then it's an easy bubble to land from VandeR here, and you force out the black shield. If it's on cooldown, the bubble is going to land, and you can pretty much kill the Kog'maw, or at least force him out of the lane here. So definitely in favor of Alliance, they get the lane swap, so they can now take it easy, farm up here, get a few levels before they decide if they want to kill the tower now or just want to freeze a lane with Tabzz and just make sure he can farm by himself.
And this is a very different Alliance that we've seen so far in the summer split. Of course, they've been running a lot of Shyvana, a lot of Lulu in there, maybe in a lot of Twitch or Lucian that they've not been able to get a hold of. So a lot of changes for that. We can see the game back underway, though, back at the blue buff. It will be going across to Shook, of course. So we'll see whether they continue this buddy system, when they do manage to four-man it up in the top there. Jankos is having to do the same, but he's on his own, so you can see he's got that level, slight level difference over Shook.
Yeah, so he's actually going to be, as you just said, slightly ahead. It means, however, Zazas is going to be a bit behind, and now because he's up in this top lane here, and because also we had VandeR recalling from the bottom lane, Alliance know there's a chance multiple members from RoCCAT are up here in this top lane, so they sent everyone to make sure RoCCAT can't do anything to stop Tabzz from farming, and also to stop Tabzz and Nyph from hitting the tower.
They have managed to come around there. Shook actually coming around, he's going to put pressure onto VandeR. Wickd with that Counter-Strike running, didn't they choose to leap on towards him? And that puts Zazas in a little bit of trouble. The rest of RoCCAT coming around, they can't try and join him at the top. That is going to be a dark point. It landed on Jankos, but still, good Aqua Prism catches on Tabzz. That will slow down the attack on the tower. And for now, RoCCAT have put up a good defense on this top tower.
Yeah, but again, notice how Alliance they played. They run straight past the tower into RoCCAT to force them away to make sure that RoCCAT knows, okay, the rest of Alliance are here. We can't try and kill Tabzz. We can't try anything. Just let the minions die here, let them back away. And as soon as Alliance actually pushed RoCCAT away, they just back away, go down to Wraith Camp, and now actually want to decide to back away a little bit. Jankos, though, he's chasing, and Overpow is coming in.
Overpow comes on, Gold Card lands on Wickd, but he had the Counter-Strike running. It catches on Overpow, stuns him up. Froggen joins the fray, and they will have to step away once again. Very well played by Wickd there.
Yeah, Flash used by VandeR, Ghost by Overpow here, so two summoners invested into trying to get a kill, and Wickd could just jump out, stun Overpow, and then run away. Didn't have to use any of his summoners. Oh, Nyph's come back.
Interrupt VandeR. He's just like, what? I was in the shop. I don't know. I was biting something. I don't know what just happened there. While this is all happening, of course, Celaver has been on his own down that bottom lane for a period of time, and he's cleverly held that lane, kept it frozen, so when Wickd ever does come down here, which may be a while yet, you can see he's quite happy to continue that buddy system. Overpow caught out, good stun, Froggen comes straight in. The damage dealt to Overpow was a little bit surprising and maybe caught him out, which is why we could see Chuck and Wickd maybe try and sneak around the back. I think they're just going to be happy taking away the raids once again.
So again, because they have two members up in the top lane, because Froggen is putting so much pressure in the mid lane, it means Alliance can then move into the jungle of RoCCAT and just take away everything they want. Because if Overpow tries to run out and help again, Froggen is just going to stun him and do even more damage to him. So there's nothing he can do to actually help Jankos in the jungle farming. And now Alliance back up in this top lane here, just to make sure that all the members from RoCCAT won't be able to do anything to hurt Tabzz from farming.
Oh, again, that sweeping lens coming into action, clearing out that ward instantly was replaced, though. So, Golems will be picked up, and while this is all happening, Zazas has kept himself relatively safe. However, he's only got 4 CS, Wickd as well, only at level 3 as well, but 11 CS with that buddy system. This time around, he is going to go down towards the bottom lane now, which Celaver's continue to hold his ground. However, in terms of CS between the two AD carriers, it is still equal.
Yeah, both have just been farming pretty much for themselves. I mean, yeah, okay, there's been members to try and help Tabzz, but nothing where he actually had to move away from the minions. He just stood there, farmed away. Wickd, of course, is underleveled, when it comes to Celaver, so it can be a little bit hard for him to push his wave out, but he's going to just go all in for it. He has, of course, the Counter-Strike to block the auto-attacks, and therefore, he wants to simply push the wave into the tower of Rocket, so the tower kills all the minions and therefore resets everything, and the two minions instead, two minion waves instead meets in the middle of the lane, so Wickd can actually farm safely.
That's what I was trying, but he saw him straight away. Celaver went instantly aggressive on him. Tabzz keeping that wave clear. Nyph trying to run interference, trying to zone them out. Level 1 style back there, pretty much. Season 1, sorry, at style. As they went for the instant zoning. Remember those tutorials many, many, many moons ago back in Season 1. Darkbinding lands, but the damage going on towards Zazzas. Three members of RoCCAT holding this top lane, but nothing coming off it. So Jankos is wasting a little bit of time here. He's still got that level advantage over Shook still, though, in the jungle.
Down the bottom lane here, Wickd was actually forced to back away from the lane, has to go to do the golems here because Celaver put a lot of pressure onto him. For now though, he's gonna recall so Wickd can go into the lane, pick up a little bit of farm once the wave actually hits down towards him. At least he can now push it all the way out, reset it, and therefore try and get some farm.
I think ward cleared out by Shook. It will be the red buff for Jankos though, so he'll be happy. At least he's got a buff secured. It did mean that Overpower had to come over once again defensively. He's under a lot of pressure in this mid lane and losing out in farm, which is a bit of a problem because Anivia generally isn't strong until level 6. Now that he's hit 7, he's only going to farm more and more.
Yeah, and also once he picks up the blue buff, which he should be able to pick up fairly easily because they have the two members up in this top lane here, because Celaver is stuck in the bottom lane without a teleport, of course, where Wickd has teleport. So RoCCAT won't be able to move in, stop this blue buff from happening, and therefore it's gonna go over to Froggen, and he can now just wave clear for days with it. The next blue buff could be the target for RoCCAT to try and take it away, and therefore force Froggen into a situation where he won't be able to just defend the tower or wave clear lane without going out of mana.
Well, speaking of problems, there's a big problem in that bottom lane. Celaver has got himself that BF sword, which as we just saw, actually he didn't quite catch a glimpse of it, but he had a small engagement with Wickd, who's just teleported in there. It's a 3-level difference right now. Wickd cannot leave his tower area in danger of being bullied down. That Counter-Strike having to be worked very well to keep those basic attacks away from him. You can see how much punishment he's been able to put out. There's Overpower getting stunned up. That wall already being made use of by Froggen.
And no potions left on Overpower. I'm not sure if he has any stacks on his flask. He did actually have 2 stacks left on it, so can at least get some health back here. But of course, he's going to pick up a blue buff as well. Meanwhile, VandeR actually moved down to this bottom lane here. So two members from RoCCAT putting a lot of pressure onto Wickd.
Yeah, Wickd hasn't hit level 6 yet, of course. Diving onto a Jax on a tower is always a dangerous thing. But now that Jankos is there, Wickd puts the ward down timely there to catch that Tribush attempt coming towards him. He does have help. Nyph has to be careful he doesn't go down the river. We'll get caught out, but immediately that ward again placed just at the right time. Gives him vision. Sneaks one into the Dragon Pit corner as well, just to make sure they're not going to start that off.
Of course, RoCCAT will be able to have Shyvana teleporting down, so they're going to be 5 members, but they're going to give up a lot, especially also in the top lane. And this mid lane here, a lot of pressure now from Alliance. They just instant push off the wave. Jankos coming behind, so is Nami.
Yeah, clever use of that pressure because, of course, they were starting to put that pressure on that bottom tower, and Alliance immediately counteracting it, putting pressure somewhere else. Wickd taken low, and that was why they had to force that pressure in that mid lane. Had to take them away, but you can see Jankos is going to start the dragon.
Teleport on cooldown for Wickd. Zazzas can join in if a fight should break out here. So RoCCAT starting this dragon here, definitely in a big advantage if a fight should break out. For now though, it's only Froggen moving down.
It's only Froggen, but he's on Anivia. He's got the blue buff. He's level 8. Teleport comes in. Zazzas. Froggen has to get the hell out of there. Has that wall available if he needs it. That will be dragon secured for RoCCAT.
Managed to pick it up here. Jankos did drop a little bit low here, but still, very smart move by RoCCAT, really using the teleport advantage. It means, however, Tabzz can get a lot of damage and should actually be able to kill the tower up here.
Yeah, the next wave is a siege minion wave. That's going to be conga lining its way around here, so Tabzz should have plenty of minions coming to join just after this wave gets cleared out. I'm not sure whether we'll get it in time. There is another pink ward cleared out there for Fire Alliance in that red buff area.
Notice also, mid lane here, the mid tower is taking so much damage because every single time the wave comes, Froggen pushes it, hits the tower a few times, and also the rest of Alliance join in, get a few hits and back away. So two very low towers here in both top and mid lane.
Well, Zansus is going to be bullied away from this one. That will be the turret, making sure the turret takes down the minions, or as many as they can. So he's actually losing out on this experience. Tabzz working it very well. Froggen still got that blue buff, overpower with his own. Is going to back off, yet to use that destiny to zip around the map. Froggen, of course, can't see Jankos. has no vision of him. The moment that ward got plinged down, he knew exactly that somebody was around there. And he's actually heading south. I wonder if he's going to go towards Wickd, who is up to level 7 now, so he's gaining some power, gaining some strength, but still nowhere near strong enough to duel with Celaver.
Yeah, very good dash from Celaver here, and just returning all the damage onto Wickd, forcing him away. But Jankos been forced to pretty much farm whenever he actually could, whenever Alliance weren't in his jungle, taking all the creeps away. And that's one of the things with Evelynn, when there's these lane swaps, it's hard to apply enough pressure on the map because people expect you to either be defending a lane, of course pushing a lane here. And Jankos, he's just been left by himself most of the time in the jungle trying to pick up a camp.
So now comes the interesting time between these two teams. Oh, Overpower, actually a bit of damage on towards him from Shook. There's a big minion wave stack there though. Dangerous play. If anybody else would have been around, maybe like an Evelynn, who they had no vision on, I'll tell a lie, he's just stepped over a pink ward, which is why they did see him. However, Froggen's caught out. The yellow card did go in there. The stun was on. It may take him to an egg here, but he's going to be up to his tower. Instead, they can turn it around. Jankos in trouble. Shook goes a little too deep. There is an og. Yeah, Shook will go down. First blood picked up. Fortunately, it was for VandeR.
The exhaust here from VandeR actually saved Jankos' life. He just put it on to Shook, sorry, when he flashed for the last hit there. Very nice play. Good turnaround from RoCCAT. Also got Froggen into the egg.
Yeah, Shook maybe going a little too deep on that one, but tried to get the kill. Let's take another look.
Just notice here, Froggen, first of all, he doesn't want to flash away because he knows he can return a lot of damage onto Overpow. Then Shook joins in. Very nice cocoon at first. But now here, look at the exhaust from VandeR, just when Shook flashes in for the last hit, and then they just turned around. Overpower lands a stun, easy kill for RoCCAT.
Good turnaround for him. So Froggen back in his mid lane. Now putting the pressure down, of course. Glacial Shroud clearing out everything he needs to. So this is the interesting time, as I was about to get to before that fight kicked off. Moving into the mid game. Alliance have lost their way a few times in this period of time. RoCCAT absolutely have lost their way a number of times in this period of time. This could be a slow period of time for both these teams, or it could snowball very, very quickly.
So it depends a lot for me about Overpower on this TF here. If he wants to start ganking around, maybe put a gank up on here on Wickd with Jankos to try and get a kill onto Sarsus and therefore just make him very, very weak. And they're going for this one.
He's going to leap away. He's managed to catch onto a ward of his own. He's going to get slowed just before he gets there, though. Wickd, has he got enough to get away from this one? I don't think he does. And Jankos picks himself up a kill.
Very, very nice gank here. Wickd was pushed very far up in the lane. There was no tower, of course, to reset the minions. Froggen, however, in this mid lane, keeps getting some damage onto this tower here. And it's just a matter of time before it goes down.
I'm just trying to wonder, I'm pretty sure you had that build to cut this before, but didn't use it.
No, I actually don't think he did. Did he?
I mean, they may have just bought it. I'm just going to quickly check.
Yeah, he just had the Vamp Scepter.
Yeah, he only just had it, so okay. I'll let him off on that one. It's not half on Wickd. I know he's going to be watching this one back later on. So, Dragon's back up in around about a minute and 45 seconds. And so far, so good for RoCCAT up against the top of the table Alliance. Pressure has worked out well for them, and the lane phase often is not really the problem for RoCCAT.
No.
As we mentioned, getting into this mid game.
And it could be a big issue for them, especially if they don't know how to take advantage of the few kills they have picked up already. Because Alliance, if you look at the late game scaling, of course Jax, absolute monster late game. Kog'maw is a monster late game. Anivia is so strong in the late game as well. So Alliance can be happy just sitting back and farm. And if you look here, both Tabzz and Froggen are out farming the counterparts. So Alliance, even though they gave up two kills, I don't really think they're going to panic at all. They just want to farm and get to the late game point.
And of course, we had that great description of Froggen's Anivia play by Krepo.
Yeah.
During the All-Stars.
All the small details.
The small details that a lot of people would miss, unless you're really staring at that mid lane battle, which, by the way, I can tell you Froggen does. We did have Katowice, and all he did was look at that mid lane.
Yep.
There's a lot of little details that can be missed. Obviously, we have to show you the entire game. If only we could have a single camera placed on every single lane to show you every little moment. But not too sure your eyes, definitely my eyes, couldn't follow that much action all at the same time.
It would be pretty hard at least.
Yes, it would be pretty tricky. So, Dragon coming up in 20 seconds, and it looks like Alliance are moving into position this time around. They do have Teleport available, which is probably why we're seeing Zazas going so aggressive on Wickd here. I don't think he has enough to take him down. Both of them having to use that Bilgewater Cutlass. There is the mid-tower going down. Looks like Wickd has escaped this time around, and the fact that Zazas has already used that ulti tells me Wickd may back. and teleport back to Dragon.
Yeah, he could do it at least, and there won't be any ulti on Sasus here for the fight. However, Celaver can at least pick up his bot tower here. Alliance to start to Dragon.
They're going to start it off. The question is, will RoCCAT get involved? You can see Jankos run stealth his way in there. Has managed to get in unseen. He's going to come in, try and smite it away. It's not going to work out. There's going to be Shook. He's stuck in the corner. He'll go down in the pit. There's going to be Zazzas. He's caught out, but they're not going to follow through in this one. Alliance choosing to back away. RoCCAT will not pursue.
So basically the trade, a kill to RoCCAT for the Dragon here for Alliance, definitely in favor of Alliance, and also both top laners had to use the teleport, even though none of them actually really got in the fight.
Yeah, and he did of course see the bottom tower did not go down. I think it will do this time around.
One Tabzz hit.
Is heading down there, but I don't think he wants to get too close to this one. As you mentioned, just one hit is enough. Celaver finishes that off. So,
oh, Nyph.
2-1 in towers. Nyph gets caught out, but the Black Shield is enough to get him away. Nicely played. As he pulls out his ulti to back him off. We also saw in the mid lane, Froggen was jumped on, but escaped as well.
And a very nice sneaky move here from RoCCAT. Walking down to the bush here, as soon as the tower died, Nyph didn't expect anyone to be there. Just thought Celaver would kill the tower and then back away all by himself. But there were two members waiting in the bush here. So very, very nice play by RoCCAT. That of course got the flash and ulti away from Nyph.
Working out well for them. So, fairly even game, just 300 gold between these two teams coming up to the 18-minute mark. Both mid laners backing off. They've both got the Athenes already. We do see a meaty large rod being picked up by Froggen, so he's going to go straight for damage. You never really know what you're going to get from Froggen's Anivia. He's put Warmog's in there. He's
Soul Stealer.
Soul Stealer. He's put all sorts in there. Meanwhile, we see the Sheen coming out from Overpower. No surprise, heading towards that Lich Bane.
And up in this top lane here, we saw Sasus go straight for Blade of the Ruined King. Very first item. It makes you weaker in team fights because you won't be as tanky here. But when it comes to the one-on-one against the Jax, it could be a little bit risky, but still, ooh, he really wants to snowball that VandeR.
Oh, VandeR having to flash out of that one. Good Aqua Prison landing. Destiny called out. Overpower, what are you doing? Shook is... Well, Overpower obviously knew exactly what he was doing. He had the support. There's four, five members of RoCCAT up in this top area. I tell you what, Wickd may need to be careful. He's on that tower on his own with five members of RoCCAT just beneath him.
And down the bottom lane, Tabs is just pushing up because all the members from RoCCAT are gone. No teleport on Sasus. The rest of Alliance here just waiting for RoCCAT to dive onto Wickd and then push the bot lane instead.
Jax is very hard to tower dive. He has that counter-strike, which can be so important. We do see the wave missing, but the Aqua Prison does land. That's going to be enough. He's going to pounce across. Had flash available, was trying to get across the wall in towards the jungle there, but not quite enough. It's a tower picked up for RoCCAT and a kill.
Kill and a tower here, lost the bottom tower, rest of Alliance actually decides to back away except for Tabzz and Nyph, they're still pushing.
Four members of Alliance now come across towards this top lane. Oh, this is sneaky! Sneaky, you may even say it, from RoCCAT, going towards the Baron, and that's quickly caught out. Alliance realize it, they've got a ward placed in the river. All of Alliance coming across. If Anivia catches them in this pit, it is dangerous, dangerous times. That Glacial Shroud could cause so much damage, the stun does not land, and RoCCAT get out just in time.
So while they didn't get the Baron, they forced Alliance away from this bot lane here, therefore they didn't lose the tower. So actually very, very smart move by RoCCAT, forcing Alliance to simply go and stop them.
Very, very sneaky play from these two teams. So Alliance, they're going back to where they wanted to go. They're going straight across towards that bottom inner turret. Will they try and pull on towards it? Blue Wolf has just spawned. Taking that away from Overpower will be crucial. Shortening that Destiny cooldown, of course. We'll take that one away. Froggen does pick it up as well, so very happy with that one. Trading the blue buffs, actually. I think it was Jankos that picked up the last one when they invaded the Alliance jungle. Froggen's going to come across. He's defending out this mid turret. He will clear out this minion wave from RoCCAT. They can't get close to it. It's still almost untouched.
Yeah, well, it is Anivia who can just wave clear with a blue buff forever. I mean, we've seen it so many times with Anivia, and that's why Alliance, even though they're giving up these kills, can just extend the game. RoCCAT, they need to move to different lanes than where Froggen is and put pressure there. They need Overpower to teleport around, get a kill here, pick up a tower in the bot or the top lane, and then they need to keep putting pressure onto Wickd up in his top lane here, who's actually been shot down pretty well by RoCCAT so far, except if you look at the farm part.
Yeah, you can see they're equal in farm, but there is two assists for Zazzas, but Wickd is continuing to farm. He's continuing to get it going. He's still very happy. If you look at the gold, it's only a 250, 300 gold differential between those two top laners. So while he's been fairly inactive, he's actually kept up the farm. And that's all he's got to do. This is not his period of gameplay. 20 minutes into this game, he does not need to be the man on the board. It's all about, obviously, this mid lane, Froggen and Tabzz, keeping everyone active. And that's exactly what they're doing. It's working well for them. RoCCAT, they're going to try and make a play here. They're making a move towards Alliance's jungle. Shook, I'm not sure he's ready for it. He's going to take some damage. Aqua Prism was dodged, so they're going to turn it back around. Glacial Shroud on towards VandeR. Dark Binding catches. Shook just about repels in time. Is it going to be enough to get away? Celaver's now the focus target. Nyph comes in towards him. Celaver goes down. Tabzz gets him down. Froggen his gun into an egg. Zassus is now focused on. He goes down. It's a double. Once again for Tabzz, proving to be the man in the Fantasy League.
And I'm not sure what RoCCAT is thinking here. They move four members to the mid lane against the blue buff Anivia to try and push the tower. Instantly it gets wave cleared. Then they move into the jungle. We're gonna see it here. Move in. Sugar's gonna be the target. He can even repel the bubble, even if it should actually land onto him. Therefore, an easy frame to dodge around it. Yes, Overpower comes in. There's the repel now, still for the stun. And now you're fighting in this jungle area against Anivia, against the Jax stun, of course, against Morgana. All these champions here from Alliance, they fight really well on small areas, like in the jungle. And Tabzz just walks in behind when everyone is low and picks up two kills.
And when you have one of the almost max range AD carries just sitting in a bush, quite happy to just turn his minigun around. Jankos now caught out, taken low, the dragon up. And honestly, with that much hit points, I'm not sure they now can contest this next dragon.
And Wickd now up in this top lane here, pushing with teleport. He can join in, or he can just stay and push if Alliance can stall the dragon, stall RoCCAT from doing the dragon, I should say. For now, though, RoCCAT actually did decide to back away, didn't want to start it straight up.
It seems that Alliance are not too interested. They're going to clear out this first wave, then rotate back down towards that dragon. You can see they have full vision of RoCCAT with that ward placement that hasn't been spotted, it seems, why RoCCAT as Alliance start out dragon.
Starting off the dragon here, they are pinging towards it. They're actually pinging for Froggen here. They know he's in there. Oh, VandeR,
oh,
you're dead.
VandeR's in all sorts of trouble. A lot of damage going down towards him. Teleport comes in. That's going to be Wickd joining the fray. Jankos caught up once again by another Dark Binding. They chase on towards him. Wickd split off a little bit here. Zassus is going to be the focus target. He's going to try and run away from this one, but he gets caught with the Dark Binding. Pounced on by Wickd. He goes down. It's a 1-0 exchange. And now the dragon this time will get started out by Alliance.
So VandeR was forced out of the fight instantly. Couldn't even use the tidal wave here to help Zassus chasing on to Alliance. And then we just saw the kiting potential when you have Anivia, when you have Morgana, of course, when you have Tabzz on this Kog'maw here with the Trinity Force just kiting around. And it's so hard for RoCCAT to get onto Alliance. And therefore, whenever they go in, they just have to back away instantly. And if they get hit by a binding or a stun, they die.
Well, they just saw the blue buff is back up. That's where Alliance is going to go next. You can see RoCCAT quickly trying to move towards that one. I'm not sure whether Jankos wanted to try and rush in and maybe steal it away. Instead, it's a pink ward that spots him, so he's not going to be able to get in undercover. Mid lane is taking some damage, though. Overpower's got himself a bit of free time to put some damage down on it. With that Lich Bane, there's quite a lot of damage going down on there. Sidesteps the cocoon and the Dark Binding. Doesn't quite get the tower yet.
And this Lich Bane here on Overpower can actually be very, very important, because as long as he can get in, just get one hit on the tower every single time they push it down, they will always be able to get them lower and lower. We see how much damage he can do already just with two items, but one of them is the Lich Bane. So I really like the pickup, because they know the wave is going to be cleared fairly fast. So it might just be one hit back away every time there's a wave.
Expect probably the Zhonya's Hourglass, I guess, to follow. We did see RoCCAT, they're trying to rotate and see if they can get that blue buff. It has just been taken away. We saw Froggen picking that one up. So what is next for these two teams? Still equal in kills, of course. Advantage in towers is Alliance's. They have taken a couple of dragons as well, so they have the gold advantage, you can see, which is just 4,000 gold between these two teams in the 25-minute mark. This is where we were talking about the pressure. Nobody really has control of the game just yet. Overpower taking a lot of damage from both Froggen and Tabzz there. That's a dangerous situation. Without the Zhonya's Hourglass, he's going to be careful he doesn't get caught out, because there's a cocoon coming his way, there's the ice ball coming his way, and of course, don't forget, there's the Dark Binding coming his way. So three opportunities that he could get caught out, nearly landed on him there.
And even with the Hourglass, it's going to be hard for him because of the wall from Froggen, because of the slow. He can predict both the binding from Nyph and the stun from Froggen onto the Hourglass as soon as it runs out. So even with the Hourglass, it's actually very scary for Overpower to do anything here. Therefore, we might see him actually start trying to split push in one lane, and then you have Zassus in the other lane fighting against Wickd, and therefore RoCCAT just want to try and avoid team fighting and want to play the map instead.
The red buff stolen away. We'll see what Tabzz does with this one. He's now got double buff, of course. Everything's starting to be stolen away from RoCCAT's jungle. They have to start getting some vision back, because You can see all those wards were placed. They went aggressive in towards that blue buff jungle, but they wasn't there. And yet they don't have any coverage of their own jungle because that's been swept out. Wickd sticking around on this tower. Counter-Strike does land on Tabzz, but leaps away for now. We do see, of course, Froggen clearing out that mid wave, which is why Overpower's coming across. RoCCAT thinking of going aggressive on this one. I'm not sure it's the wise choice. Instead, Overpower, he's going to take a large portion of the damage from Shook there. Now you can see Nyph coming around the corner. Captures up and locks up Jankos. Jankos goes down. Tabzz is the one doing the damage. Now Zazzas is the next focus target. He's going to get caught out with the range that Tabzz has to offer. And that was a questionable decision by RoCCAT to engage.
Yeah, they simply fell there to try something. So while Froggen was in the mid lane pushing, they saw a few members from Alliance and just used the teleport from Overpower to try and start a fight. However, it was too easy for Alliance again to just turn it around. And they are so strong in these teamfights.
Oh, Celaver almost caught the wrong side of the wall. You can see trying to keep him away from that Baron. Tabzz with that ultimate has such a long range on it now. Level 14 hasn't quite maxed it out. But that's a Baron for Alliance.
Baron for Alliance here. Even though, again, we talked about how early on they gave up some kills. They were actually behind 4 kills if you look at the early game. But they kept farming. Froggen and Tabzz were always ahead on farm compared to Overpower and Celaver. And as soon as then we got to team fights, especially the one in the jungle of Alliance, that's where they really showed the power of both the champions and, of course, of Alliance as a team. Picked up the kills, got the lead here, and actually just hold on to the lead so far.
A big chunk of change has just been spent and a Void Staff bought outright by Froggen there in that Anivia mid laner. AD carries, you can see there is a advantage building for Tabzz. The fact that he is 4-0-1 now. With that last whisper on him, not going to worry too much about the Randian Omen that's been stacked on by Zazzas, but honestly, he is the only member with some armor on him right now, which is maybe a bit of a problem starting to build for RoCCAT because Kog'maw is certainly becoming very strong.
Yeah, there's more than just one problem for RoCCAT now. Jax, of course, Trinity Force and Blade. Kog'maw is very, very strong, already got Last Whisper as well. Froggen, you just talked about how he picked up the Void Staff. So many champions from Alliance here who can carry a teamfight by themselves. And I still need to see what this TF pick is actually going to do, because I believe the last teleport we saw could maybe even be the first we've actually seen in the game as an aggressive move onto to try and start a fight or a gank. We didn't actually see Overpower do anything in lane because he was just pressured down by Kog'maw all the time.
This is the problem with the Kog'maw. Look at the range he has once he hits that long range shot. So you can see just poking it over the waves. No problem there, and that's just one simple burst down. They've taken that hit points of that tower completely. This is going to be another tower going down. Wickd will take this, no problem. No way RoCCAT can rotate around and defend this one because they'll lose the mid inhib turret. We do see in the mid lane, though, look at Jankos trying to sneak around.
Trying to sneak around, he's going in.
He's going to go in towards it, but instantly backs out. The wave does not get caught because Overpower was simply dropped where he stood. Aqua Prison lands on Wickd, but that will not get followed up either. That's going to be an easy inhibitor turret. They may go on towards Celaver, gets caught with a cocoon, but they do not follow through. They have a big minion wave coming down towards his bottom inhibitor turret.
Can just push in with it here, get a lot of damage onto the tower, might even try and go for the dive.
And they're going to pounce in there. Zazzas just gets absolutely destroyed. What was he thinking going in there up against so much damage? Jankos gets pounced on, he gets forced away, and well, that's a second in him going. Well, Alliance, they may finish the game right now.
Seems
or not.
No, just playing it safe, backing away here, have a lot of gold with all the towers they just picked up with the kills. Of course, everyone above 1,000 gold they can use. And Wickd actually can also use teleport just to pick up some more farm.
Well, it's important to keep that inner turret available. Maybe needed just a little bit extra gold to back away, but we just saw there Zazzas, you know, the fight spat, he's got the Iranian's Omen on him. It literally did nothing. He disappeared in seconds.
Died pretty much, yeah, instantly. I mean, again, Last Whisper on Tabzz, he just does so much damage to him. Froggen, of course, on Anivia, there's so little magic on Zazzas. And there's the Soul Stealer, of course.
There is the Mickey Soul Stealer book to start stacking it out. He's only just bought it, so I don't think there's any stacks on it just yet.
No.
Nothing on it just yet, of course, but we'll see. I don't think he's going to have enough time to stack that book out, but why not, honestly? He's 1-0-6,
yeah.
Been under zero pressure, been involved in almost everything, 95% of the kills so far for Alliance, and those waves, they're not lasting long, of course. His Baron buff still has around about a minute left on it, so that tower will fall. question is, will these final inhibitor turret go down? I feel that they may be playing for some fantasy points here as they try to clear out every tower in the game.
RoCCAT just have to try fight where they land every single CC from them and just try and burst down the first target. But who? Froggen has the egg, of course, he won't die. Tabzz staying so far back anyway, and Sazz has already poked down to 50%.
Please explain any other reason why you do this. Why would you go for this turret when you have super minions coming up the middle and bottom lane? There's no reason whatsoever to be fighting on a tower right now.
Well, that's actually a very good case. I mean, they could just push up here, but then RoCCAT can just wait down with their Nexus towers. Well, and now Sazz is coming in behind them.
Teleporting behind, the wave doesn't land. He gets caught with a Dark Binding, pounces onto Wickd, and instantly is locked up by that Dark Binding. So they try to counter and flank around the sides, and again, it's just not worked.
Didn't work here, but of
course. Super minions all over the Nexus turret right
now. They can do the work themselves.
They've got to deal with this. Look how much damage is done on that Nexus turret array. Celaver can't clear that one. That's one Nexus turret going down. They're just being countered around this side. Jankos gets caught with the Dark Binding. The second Nexus turret falls. Super minions are doing the job for him. Alliance are going to push on through. There's the inhibitor turret going down. Every single turret of the game has dropped. Every inhibitor has gone down. And Alliance push on through to RoCCAT's base.
They want
the kills. They are doing nothing to stop this one. They do want the kills. I'm not sure they even can get them. Well, of course they can. Tabzz gets himself another. The Nexus will fall. Alliance continue to be top of the table with 6 wins and 1 loss.
Fantastic team fight from Alliance in this game here.